There was always a chink in the armor of the Bower's pose of cloudless congeniality. Its owners, often young and inheriting vast lands and dozens of human beings willed on them without their say, would often live too well, too sociably, thus committing the Thomas Jefferson violation. Thomas Jefferson struggled, owning too many people from his wife's dowry, but insisting on his wines and fanciful projects. When the day came, his accountant told him the fact that he could lose Monticello for debts. The face of Thomas Jefferson paled in horror. So he sold people, people that were born and grown at Monticello. To his overseer, Joel Yancey, Thomas Jefferson wrote with a vile, hypocritical air that the labor of a breeding woman is more profitable than the crop of the best laboring man. Monticello, January 17, Sunday. The mortality among our Negroes is still more serious as involving moral as well as interested considerations. They are well fed and well clothed, and I have no reason to believe that any overseer since Griffin's time has overworked them. Accordingly, the deaths among the grown ones seem ascribable to natural causes, but the loss of five little ones in a year induces me to fear that the overseers do not permit the women to devote as much time as is necessary to the care of their children, that they view their labor as the first object and their raising their child but as secondary. I consider the labor of a breeding woman as not objectionable, and that a child raised every 2 years is of more profit than the crop of the best laboring man. In this, as in all other cases, Providence made our interests and duties coincide perfectly. Women, too, are destroyed by exposure to wet at certain periodical indispositions to which nature has subjected them. With respect, therefore, to our women and their children, I must pray you to inculcate upon the overseers that it is not their labor, but their increase, which is the first consideration with us. January 17, 1819, Thomas Jefferson.
Now, getting by. Our people was at the bow. See, we learned this. And all we know that our grandmother, first name was Murray. That's all we know was Murray. They decided that they were going to stop buying slaves, having them shipped over here, because they come over on those boats, they're all tired, they get sick and everything, and so many of them would die. So we will take so many of these strong women and we will just have children. So let them bear the children here. And they picked her for one, but she refused it. So of course you don't tell your masters what you're not going to do. So Uncle Dewey said they lost, they saw of their mother. She was in. A wagon with one horse pulling it, tied in there, and they were beating her. So these was left in the cabinet. Up on the bow is a house they call the Fox's House. So that's where they were. One was named Umford, one was named Benjamin, one was named Steve, one was named John, and a girl named Mary. I guess she named after her mother. Umford, he lived in a house up there. They called it Pine Hills then. Probably was up on that damaged land. Steve went to Ohio, so they lost trace of him. Benjamin was the little preacher, and he was down in Virginia. Mary went to Pennsylvania, Kalau, and lost trace of her. Now my brother went up to Kalau and was searching around, and he found this Mary Shadden living up there. But before he could finish the research, he died. So it just stopped there. I asked the lady Holmes that came down. She said, yeah, it was boxes up there, but she didn't know what's what.
During the interview in May 2002, did Jim Surkamp's question, what happened to their mother, Mary? Bertha turned her head, looked at me incredulous, and said, they killed her. By whom? The overseer for the Bower, Henry Swigert, had been killed in a train accident in the mid-1850s, just when the debt-ridden farm of another Dandridge sibling to Adam Stephen was collapsing and its enslaved persons were being sent south. It's plausible that his overseer, Davy Hunter, took up the responsibilities at the Bower where he was needed and to fill in Swigert's place. That the 1860 census lists the Bower owner, Adam Stephen, as being disabled by blindness suggests the responsibilities of running the place during that time may have devolved over to Hunter. Adam Stephen in 1860, according to the census, did not live at the main house, but alone with his blindness in a smaller dwelling nearby, presumably for care and personal safety from injury. Charles Fox, Mary's great-great-grandson, writes, 4 1/2 generations ago and 6 miles away from Papa's. Mary, a handsome mulatto woman, lifts the long skirt to her plain cotton dress. Slips down the wooden steps from the rear of the Bower. Beneath the luminescent smile of the waning moon, the shadow of a large two-story brick federal structure rises above her. Looking back, she makes sure no one detects her. Soft, warm flickers of light from the sitting room fireplace are the only movement in the windows as she disappears into the night. Especially in the dark, Mary is sure-footed and quick. The midwife taught her that plants absorb light and hardened soil reflects it. So, in the black of night, if she focuses on the ground, the worn path's subtle glow will reveal the way through the darkness to the quarter farm. Her children were hidden there. If the master did not know about her children, and there was no record, they would be able to escape. That's what Mary envisioned. When a voice pierced the darkness, "Where are you going?" It was the Irish overseer hired by the master to watch over the property. Since Mary and the midwife conspired to report her children as stillborn, neither the master, his wife, nor the overseer knew that Mary had given birth to 5 healthy children. So, the children had not been listed on the master's inventory of slaves and property. Mary might not ever see freedom in her lifetime, yet the brilliance of her cunning persistence to free her children shone like the light only she could see in the darkness. "I said, where are you going? I'm not going to ask you again." Distracting her questioner's attention from the light she followed, Mary straightens her posture and turns to face him with fists tightened. Then she extends her hands, opens them, and reveals leftovers of food balanced in her palms. "Just going to feed some little baby foxes been abandoned by their mama." Charles Fox wrote, "Mary, my great-great-grandmother, a handsome mulatto woman in her 30s, tied to a wagon wheel, is beaten and taken away in the back of a horse-drawn wagon. Like the old oak trees pay witness, so does old midwife Lucy, keeper of dreams and secrets, older than Enoch. Devil winds raise fallen leaves of whispered questions. What about the children? Was the mother sold? Was she killed? What children?" Master turned and walked away, not looking back, a descendant reports. Shame, a secret pain, like footprints mark his trail. The Fox family history, coming down from John Fox, describes Adam Stephen Dandridge as deeply despondent after Mary's death. "He went on a 4-day drunk in the woods." Adam Stephen instructed that the 5 Fox children, all younger than 10, be brought into the big house to be raised. They were fed in the kitchen from a big bowl of milk and bread with the cats and dogs. But Bertha stresses, they learned to read and write. Dewey Fox, John Fox's son, also passed on to Bertha that Mrs. Adam Stephen Dandridge, Serena Catherine, and the mistress of the house would sometimes dab the children's lips with a greasy substance for reasons only known to her. John Pendleton Kennedy, a real-life cousin to Mrs. Adam Stephen Dandridge, used his observations of her in his famous reflection called Swallow Barn that he firmly said was not a made-up novel. He called his cousin Lucretia. Everything at Swallow Barn that falls within the superintendence of my cousin Lucretia is a pattern of industry. In fact, I consider her the very priestess of the American system. Moreover, all things go like clockwork. She rises with the lark and infuses an early vigor into the whole household. And yet she is a thin woman to look upon, and feeble with a sallow complexion, and a pair of animated black eyes which impart a portion of fire to a countenance, otherwise demure from the paths worn across it. But although her life has been somewhat saddened by such visitations of ague, my cousin is too spirited a woman to give up to them, for she is therapeutical in her constitution, and considers herself a full match for any reasonable tertian in the world. Indeed, I have sometimes thought she took more pride in her leechcraft than becomes a Christian woman. She is even a little vainglorious. Men say what they choose about it being contrary to reason and all that. It is their way, but seeing is believing. 9 scoops of water in the hollow of the hand from the sycamore spring for 3 mornings before sunrise and a cup of strong coffee with lemon juice will break an ague. Try it when you will. I am occasionally up early enough to witness her morning regimen, which to my mind is rather tyrannically enforced against the youngsters, both white and black. She is in the habit of preparing some death-routing decoction for them in a small pitcher and administering it to the whole squadron in succession. In the home department, she is confessedly, without appeal, the paramount power. Were there emotions between Mary, the owned one, and Adam Stephen Dandridge, Serena Catherine's husband? Two mothers. On future legal documents, a marriage certificate and a death certificate, brothers Humphrey and John Fox did not list Mary as their mother, but John Fox as their father, and their mother as Betsy Dennis. Perhaps after Mary's death, Betsy Dennis may have been the midwife who delivered all the 5 children, a secret shared. Philip C. Pendleton, Power in a Velvet Glove. The man most likely to have uncovered the existence of Mary's unlawful family, and was also the man who had the legal power to do something about it, was Philip C. Pendleton, the man who held the lives, hopes, and fates of all persons of color in a jurist's balance, the one who visited the quarter regularly to hobnob and check up on things, and who, beneath his languorous patrician air, really ran things, making sure debts were paid. He was the brother of Sarah Pendleton Dandridge, the widow of Adam Stephen Dandridge I, mother of Adam Stephen Dandridge II, and in the many remaining years that she lived until the mid-1850s, her brother Philip Pendleton, a lawyer and one-time judge, controlled and managed all the land and property and people as he saw fit in the estate of his sister's husband. He was to be feared. He was the lead executor at three advertised auctions of people on Bowerland and the Quarter. John Pendleton Kennedy renamed his uncle Philip C. Pendleton Frank Merriweather in Swallow Barn, that is to say, the Bower, but keeping the facts of Pendleton intact. Kennedy retreated from using an account found only in his first draft of the notorious hate stare of Pendleton's. After a slave had grinned saucily and good-humoredly at his master's stupidity, it is said that my uncle looked up at the black with the most awful face he ever put on in his life. It was blood red with anger, but bethinking himself for a moment, he remained silent as if to subdue his temper. He did not speak one word. If he had not constrained himself by his silence, he would probably have attacked his slave with a stick. Frank Merriweather has, by arrangement, taken possession of the inheritance together with the family. Ned has ample liberty to pursue his own whims in regard to his future occupation in life. Ned Hazard was Adam Stephen Dandridge II, renamed, but the real-life details remain intact. Kennedy continues about his relative. It pains me to say that Hazard's days of academic glory at Princeton were untimely cropped, but my veracity as a chronicler compels me to avow, even to the disparagement of my friend, that before his course had run its destined end, he made shipwreck of his fortunes and received from the faculty a passport that warranted an unquestioned egress from Nassau Hall. Ned crept quietly back to Swallow Barn, and in the lonely pursuits of this period, he engendered that secret love of adventure and picturesque incident that took him upon his celebrated expedition around the Horn. But it in no degree conquered his mirthful temper. His mind is still a fairyland inhabited by pleasant and conceited images, winged charmers, laughing phantoms, and mellow specters of frolic. Frank holds the estate for the present under an honorable pledge to relieve it of its burdens by a gradual course of thrifty husbandry.
Let's get on the block. Let's get on the block. Let's get on the block.
In the quarter, most of these own people lived in picturesque moss-covered cabins, dotting the hillside on the 443-acre landscape. We observing their gardens, roiling and simblings, cucumbers, sweet potatoes, watermelons, and cabbages, dodging chickens. past welcoming doorstep mothers and darting little children, going into their homes unannounced, and I insert possibly the way Uncle Philip could have found out Mary's secret unregistered children. Kennedy goes on. He has constituted himself into a high court of appeal and makes it a rule to give all their petitions a patient hearing and to do justice in the premises. In almost every house where he entered, there was some boon to be asked, and I observed that in every case, the petitioner was either gratified or refused in such a tone as left no occasion or disposition to murmur. Most of the women had bargains to offer of fowls or eggs or other commodities of household use, and Philip generally referred them to his wife. "That, sir," said Pendleton, "is no less a personage than Jupiter. He's an old bachelor, and he has his cabin here on the hill. He's now near 70, and is a kind of king of the quarter. He has a horse which he extorted from me last Christmas, and I seldom come here without finding myself involved in some new demand as a consequence of my donation. Now he wants padding for his saddle, which he said galled his creature's back." Kennedy adds, "And after a few jocular passages with the veteran, Uncle Philip gave him what he desired." I add, Mary's secret would be found out in the quarter one day. Then, one day,
our grandmother, first name was Murray, as all we know was Murray.
This foolish trick. This foolish trick.
My great-great-grandmother, Mary, she is spoken of as she really walked in the bower's autumn oak leaves, across the wooden planks of its winter floors, and whispers reminders of compassion from a distant world that holds no memory of her. Did she